war, madness, and dreams of empire. As Sweden enters into the early modern age, it embarks on a journey which will lead to the country establishing itself as one of Europe's great powers, with a near complete dominion over the Baltic Sea. Far from being a straight path, the road to empire would be ripe with twists and setbacks that could have led to a quite different outcome. As the powers in Northern Europe vie for control and dominance, one country would rise above the others. This is Swedish history before the Swedish Empire. The year is 1560. And after having ruled Sweden for 37 years, the kingdom's great reformer and Machiavellian prince Gustav Vasa has just passed away, leaving the country with a robust military, as well as a navy with the might to effectively compete against Sweden's competitors in the Baltic Sea. King Gustav's reign during the first half of the 16th century is an important background to the rise of the Swedish Empire, and if you haven't seen them yet, I strongly recommend that you see my two-part series on his reign. With the old king gone, the crown is passed to his eldest son. While King Gustav had 11 children during his lifetime, only 3 of them will be of main relevance to the future of the country, called Erik, Johan, and Charles. Erik, being the oldest of the 3, is crowned king, with Johan becoming the Duke of Finland, and Charles the Duke of Värmland. As a young king, eager for prestige and glory, Erik quickly did away with his father's foreign policy in favor of war. But before that could happen, Erik found himself in an internal conflict that needed to be dealt with. In accordance with the laws of succession that had been established at the Riksdag of 1540, the Swedish crown would go to the king's oldest son, while the brothers of the heir would be given duchies to govern in the king's name. How the relationship between the king and the dukes should work was never fully made clear, however, and this quickly led to disagreements, which later would escalate into conflicts between King Erik and his brothers, primarily his brother Johan. In order to increase his power over the duchies, Erik called a Riksdag at the city of Arboga in 1561, where he managed to convince the states to support his proposal to officially expand his influence at the expense of his brothers, especially when it came to the crown's influence over law and trade regulations. This greatly angered Duke Johan, who furiously refused to accept the Parliament's decision. The tensions between the two brothers was made worse by Johan's decision to partially conduct his own foreign policy by marrying the daughter of the King of Poland, Catherine Jagiellon, something that made Erik strongly question his brother's loyalty in the case that war would break out between Sweden and Poland. The tensions eventually boiled over in 1563, when the king sent a military force that apprehended Johan and brought him, as well as his wife Katrina, to Stockholm, to later be imprisoned at Gripsholm's castle, west of the capital. With Johan dealt with, and Charles not willing to challenge him, Erik turned his attention to the southeastern Baltic shoreline, where political tensions soon were about to explode. Since the Middle Ages, the southeastern coast of the Baltic Sea had been controlled by the Teutonic and Livonian orders, which forcefully had Christianized the region during the Crusades of the High and Late Middle Ages. By the late 16th century, however, the land had been Christian for several centuries, with a large number of people, especially those living in the cities, having started to convert to Protestantism. This state of affairs led to the order's internal cohesion to collapse, with the neighboring realms marching in to claim the land in order to control the favorable trade going between the Russian inland and the Baltic Sea. Not all of the region would be conquered, however, with Russia going in and taking the city of Narva. The representatives of the city of Reval in 1561 sent out a delegation to King Eric, saying that they were willing to submit to the crown of Sweden in exchange for protection. The proposal was accepted, and with Reval as a beachhead, Sweden soon gained control over most of Estonia in 1562. Around the same time, Denmark bought the island of Ösel from the Livonian Order, while the region of Livonia decided to become part of Poland. Given the desire of all the countries to control all of the region, war soon broke out between them. In 1563, war broke out between Sweden on one side, with Denmark, Poland, and the Hanseatic city of Lübeck on the other. The conflict would mainly be fought between Denmark and Sweden, and while the territories in the east would be important, the conflict would also be fought for other territories. In addition to seizing Estonia, the King of Denmark also hoped to capture the city of Elfsborg, thereby blocking Sweden from any trade going through the North Sea, while King Eric hoped to take the regions of Skåne, Blekinge, and Halland. Though both Sweden and Denmark can be said to have been decently prepared, neither country had the military capacity to achieve its goals, which turned out to be quite unrealistic. With this state of affairs, the war soon took the form of raids along border territories, with the common folk having to experience much violence and cruelty from both sides. With neither side willing to give up, the war would drag on for 7 long years, with Eric not being king long enough to see it concluded. Eric was not mentally well and suffered from severe degrees of paranoia, which manifested in Eric convincing himself that members of the high nobility were conspiring against him. Cursed by illusions of conspiracy, several members of the country's leading noble families were apprehended on made-up charges of treason. In a weird turn of events, Eric would one morning visit the imprisoned noblemen with an escort of knights. Once having arrived, he pulled a knife and mercilessly gutted a young nobleman in front of his father, after which he ordered his entourage to execute the rest. The same afternoon, King Eric walked into his old teacher, whom he immediately ordered his knights to cut down as well. According to reports, the king is then said to have aimlessly wandered around the countryside outside Stockholm, until being found at a cemetery where he had fainted from a psychosis. Needless to say, did he not remain king for long. At the turn of the year 1568 to 1569, he was dethroned, and the crown was handed to the formerly imprisoned Johan, who, after many years of imprisonment, now became King Johan III. After being crowned king, Johan was forced to end his brother's war in 1570. Erik's escapades had taken a heavy toll on the kingdom's finances, and in order to settle the conflict with Denmark, Sweden had to pay the Danes a large ransom in order to get back Elfsborg, which the Danish forces had occupied shortly after the war had broken out. If that wasn't bad enough, new tensions were brewing in the east. Before the peace treaty with Denmark had even been signed, Russia declared war against Sweden and marched a large force into Estonia. While Sweden was anything but prepared, it did have an important advantage in King Johan's marriage with Katrina. Through utilizing the marriage ties, as well as through playing on Sweden's and Poland's shared threat from Russia, Johan managed to convince Poland to enter into an alliance and join the war against Russia. Despite the alliance, however, the war initially went in favor of the Russians, who, under the leadership of the famous Tsar Ivan the Terrible, managed to conquer most of the southeastern Baltic shoreline, with the exception of the city of Revol, which managed to hold out throughout the war due to being steadily resupplied from the sea. Russia's domination would continue until the Battle of Venden in 1578, when the forces of Sweden and Poland managed to defeat the Russian army. Soon after its defeat, the Russian military started to face internal disorder at home, which hindered their ability to effectively regroup, giving the Swedish and Polish forces the opportunity to retake the lost Baltic provinces. In 1581, the Swedish forces marched into Russia and managed to conquer both its Estonian territories as well as the region of Ingria and Kexholm, which would remain under Swedish control for almost 15 years. While there weren't any more fighting after 1581, the war wouldn't be concluded until the Peace of Tusina in 1595, in which Sweden was allowed to keep its conquered territories in Estonia, including the city of Narva, while having to give back Kexholm and Ingria. While the war with Russia would come to characterize much of King Johan's reign, it would be far from the only aspect. Two other questions that would engage the king throughout his kingship was that of religion and the throne of Poland. As one of Europe's remaining elective monarchies, the Polish succession was determined by a vote among the Polish nobility, and due to his marriage with Katrina, King Johan saw an enticing opportunity to get his heir onto the Polish throne. During the years of captivity, the royal couple had given birth to a son they named Sigismund, and once Johan had been crowned king, he decided to give Sigismund a Catholic upbringing, a decision that likely had been taken to increase his son's chances to become the king of Poland. If elected, the two countries would enter into a personal union under Sigismund, a union that would be strong enough to hold the power of Russia in check. To the king's delight, the gamble paid off. In 1587, following several years of careful diplomatic maneuvering by Swedish envoys, the Polish Diet elected Sigismund as the King of Poland and the Grand Duke of Lithuania. The results would be bittersweet, however, for despite having a son on the Polish throne, the relationship between the two kingdoms did not work out as well as Johan had hoped. Around the time of Sigismund's coronation, the Polish nobility declared that all of the land of old Livonia, which included Estonia, rightfully belonged to Poland, something King Johann refused to accept. In addition to the claims made by the Polish nobility, did the religious differences between the Church of Sweden and Sigismund's Catholic faith also stir up controversy. While King Erik had continued his father's anti-Catholic religious policy, Johann had decided to adopt a more tolerant view towards religious differences. It's important to have in mind that during most of the 16th century, Sweden, while having severed all ties to the papacy, did not have any declared state denomination like Protestantism or Calvinism. Hoping that there would be a way to reconcile the two kingdoms' religious differences, King Johann promoted religious policies intended to be more inclusive and conciliatory towards Catholicism. This included changing Swedish church services in order to make them include more Catholic practices, as well as letting foreign Jesuits travel to Sweden and restoring old Catholic cathedrals and monasteries. Despite the king's effort, his reforms were met by harsh resistance from the Church of Sweden, whose representatives saw the actions as an attempt to reintroduce Catholicism. The bickering surrounding the creed and religious rituals would continue throughout Johann's reign and would put him on bad terms with his brother, Duke Charles, who was a very pious man, ardent anti-Catholic, and someone who refused to implement the king's religious reforms in his duchy. While the tensions never broke out into open conflict, they nonetheless remained throughout King Johann's reign without being solved. When the king passed away in 1592, the church maintained its anti-Catholic stance, with the throne going to Sigismund, who was present in Poland. Once the new king crossed the Baltic Sea to claim his crown, the tensions would boil over.